The main idea is to have summaries and closing of the overview. Next week onward, we'll have the external speakers coming and talking. One speaker has canceled, so Mukund Thattai, who's going to speak Wednesday afternoon, is not going to be speaking. So basically from Wednesday afternoon onward, so the 2 o'clock session onward, is devoted for projects and then eventually the presentations. So you have about 1.5 days to really work at the end of next week to polish your presentation and your project reports, and that should give you enough time to do something interesting. Today at 11:30, Professor Seshu will be giving a talk on modeling and simulation. He would have, he was originally even scheduled to come next Wednesday, but that couldn't be arranged. So what I'm going to do in this session is three or four things. Just because what I'm trying to do here is to wrap up everything we have done so far. Basically, if you remember the So if you think of modern cognitive sciences, again, I'm giving you essentially a very rapid course in the last 4 days on what is the overall structure of this field. So I want us to wrap that up and say, well, where are we in this field? How did we get to the current status of the field? What are the things that have fundamentally been missed? And finally, where do we go next? And in the next session, I will give you a set of open questions. So many of you are at least potentially interested in research in this field, or even if you're not, you might be curious about what are the major open kind of questions. So what I'll spend most of the time in the next session is these open questions. Okay. So this is the summary. That's the research open questions. Now, here's a very basic question, right? Why is it that cognitive science or cognition isn't a central science like which everybody just uses for everything? What do I mean by that? To compare cognition with physics on the one hand and economics on the other hand. So at some level, we all agree that the universe is somehow best understood eventually by some laws of physics. I mean, that's the standard model that we all somewhere have in our heads. Now, that could be wrong, or physics may have to change radically before it covers everything. But broadly speaking, the idea is that the physical world and the current understanding of physics is the right way to go to more or less capture everything. At the other end, if you look at the human social world, for the most part, the academic discipline and the expertise that most informs our lives is economics, right? So whether it's a financial crisis and where economics goes wrong, or policy making, which tells you how to organize society, on the whole, we are run by economists, okay? And nobody consults really psychologists or cognitive scientists on how to run society. But it's sort of standard. We are, in fact, the prime minister of this country is an economist. So between lawyers and economists, they probably run a great deal of the rest of the world. Why is it that therefore cognition isn't central in this way, right? Either it tells us how to manage human affairs, or it helps us conceptualize what is the nature of the universe. And strangely, it's not as if there isn't a reason to do so. Why do I mean by that? If you look at the great developments of the 20th century, especially commercial developments, we all live essentially in the age of experience. Meaning, much of the technology that you engage with on a day-to-day basis, whether it is computers, whether it's using Google for searches, your cell phones, they are really not, they're not, unlike say cars and trains and so on, which help you go from A to B, a great deal of the most interesting and sort of coveted modern technology is either communication or entertainment or sort of intelligence technology, right? So it either makes you think better, it either helps you consume various kinds of entertainment, or it helps you talk or otherwise connect to people who you are friends with or work with, right? So that's sort of at the core of cognition. I mean, these are all things like how do you experience the world is something that we study in cognition. How do you communicate with others is something we study in cognition. And how do you think better or reason better is something we study in cognition. And yet, we don't think of, you don't think of computer science as a subset of cognition. You don't think of cell phones as a subset of cognition. You don't think of Google as a cognitive science-based company, which none of these are. And that's strange because the products that they're making are really fundamentally cognitive interfaces. And yet, there is no, I mean, sadly, it's not as if you, if you're good at cognitive science, you're immediately snapped up by the latest startup. Right? So unlike, say, a computer scientist or someone with quantitative skills, there isn't like a very high demand for top-notch cognitive scientists in the industry. So this is an issue because it tells you that the field seems to have, while addressing what might be a central aspect of existence, seems to have missed many things that otherwise would have made it actually a central discipline. And that's really what I wanted to start with, which is that how did we, as a field, get to be at this place? I mean, neuroscience is beginning to change this lack of centrality. If you read a newspaper now, almost every single day, in almost every newspaper, you will now find reports of how some brain area is involved in something, or some deficit, some person who's able to do something which is different in their brain from others. So what's beginning to happen is this idea that eventually, if you understand the brain, you will be able to understand all kinds of other stuff. So while that's beginning to happen, first of all, that's also not cognition. It's still assuming that some piece of flesh will help you understand everything. And the second point is we don't have a systematic idea of how that's going to happen. Right? And so, which is why it's exciting in some ways. It means that many questions remain open, and we will discuss them next time. But the puzzle actually is, why is it that kind of psychological or experiential or rational, the science of psychology, the science of reason and the science of experience isn't actually the central human science. If you compare that with, say, Freudian psychology, now Freud, I mean, in India we almost had no impact. Most of us never went to still don't go to a therapist or a psychoanalyst or so on, but in the West, it's the standard apparatus through which people used to engage, at least through the mid-20th to late 20th century. Almost everybody used to sort of orient themselves in Freudian ways. So whether it is unconsciousness or I am repressed, so the whole language that we now have in everything, including education, right? So the idea that children are being repressed, children are being, not being allowed to be creative, all of these, that's actually a language that arose in the early 20th century through the work of people like Freud and others. So the entire sort of culture is permeated in the West by these psychological ideas. But cognitive ideas have not had that impact. Neuroscience ideas are perhaps beginning to have that impact, but despite the importance of computation, so computer science pervades our lives, we all use the products of computation in some manner or the other. Given that computation was the central feature of cognition for so many years, why is it that that merger didn't yield a much more pervasive science? Is an interesting question to ask. I mean, so that goes to sort of the two directions in which you could say the study of the mind could have gone, only one of which, of course, has been followed up in a big way, right? So if you look at traditionally the Cartesian sense, what might be the two major aspects of the mind? To say whatever else you think the mind does, it does one of these two things. One thing is reason, and the second thing is experience. Right? Consciousness as experience is one of the sort of prototypical mental phenomena. I mean, it may eventually turn out to be a physical phenomena, but whatever it turns out to be, the place where people fundamentally associate consciousness with is the mind. Similarly, if you take reasoning and thought and intelligence, that's another area that has always been thought of as a fundamentally mental domain. And cognitive science, which was after all a derivative of mathematics and then computation and other sort of formal disciplines, comes from an analysis more of reason than of anything else. Right? So why is it that we reason the way we reason? How can we reason better? And if you are an AI person, how can you make something that reasons or is smart in the way that we are? That's sort of the overarching idea behind the mind sciences in the computational era, right? So you either, so even the way that we think about vision as inference or unconscious inference, the way we think of language as grammar, all of these sort of reflect this view that somehow a formal reasoning-like process captures what is essential about the mind. That completely omits several things. At first, of course, it omits the experience part of the conscious experience. So nothing that consists of zeros and ones tells us why we see the world in terms of reds and blues. So that's a huge gap which can't, as of now, we don't even know how to bridge. But there are other things also that this particular division and focus on reasoning and on intelligence, whatever that means, leads to. First, it also makes it difficult, if not impossible, to talk about emotion. Right? So while our lives, so our daily lives are actually far more ruled by emotion than by reason, if at all we can make that distinction. You know, you don't spend time with people who you think are better at calculating or at solving math problems. I mean, most of us spend time with people we like. So it's sort of the emotional engagement with the world and its emotional color that rules our lives. And yet cognitive science hasn't had much to say about emotion at all. And until you know, people like Damasio started asking within the neuropsychology, cognitive psychology sort of frame as to what's the relationship between reason and emotion, if at all one can divorce the two, nobody was thinking about it. Like, cognitive psychology made such dramatic advances in the study of vision, study of memory, attention, language, of course. But all of those are in this, you know, non-emotional
who's putting it off.
Without that engagement with emotion, psychology is sort of not interesting in some sense. And the great thing about Freudian psychology was it just zeroed in on our emotional lives as the central aspect of our life. And it gave a compelling narrative as to how to understand emotion. So whether, you know, it may be false, but it is, even if it's false, it's interesting, right? Dennett, the famous philosopher, wrote a, I think it was a paper, but it's part of the book, where he talks about how it's better to be interesting than to be right. Meaning, but I don't mean it in a pejorative way, though he did. Because he thinks that if you, if there's theory A, which is right, but it's sort of pedestrian, and theory B is wrong, but compelling, you always choose the latter one. He was actually talking primarily, this was his analysis of Chomsky, incidentally, not of Freud. So when he talked about Chomsky, he was like, Chomsky's idea of the universal grammar was such a powerful and compelling framework that people who resisted it by saying no, instead of this neat, simple idea of universal grammar, there is a very messy reality of different kinds of learning processes, different experience. Not a nice story. So, but the Freudian story similarly was a very compelling story of our emotional lives. And it was supposed to be scientific. We now think of it as exactly what is not science. Right? So Karl Popper, when he wrote his Logic of Scientific Discovery, and his idea that science, any scientific theory, must be falsifiable, that was directly aimed at two disciplines that claimed to be science, which according to him were not science. One was Marxism and the other was Freudian psychology. Both of them, at that time, claimed to be scientific accounts of, in one case, how society is organized, and the second, how our minds are organized. Both of them, again, are very compelling accounts. So if you think about which forces have dominated our lives as experiential, emotional, whatever, political beings in the 20th century, it was Marxism and Freudianism. So for some reason, cognitive psychology is really has nothing like the compelling power of those. Nobody has died for cognition, as far as I can tell.
On this question of science itself, you keep using the word science of phenomenology. So you still put phenomenology in the bracket of, say, science or scientific method?
I wouldn't do what Popper did in the first place, right? I don't think of falsifiability as a particularly important scientific constraint. Meaning, a lot of science is only dubiously falsifiable. I mean, let's take something like evolutionary biology. It's not clear what we could do to falsify it. It's also not clear what we could do to really prove it either, for that matter. Right? So I think that falsifiability is a too radical a constraint. And most science actually doesn't operate that way. There might be other kinds of incoherences, right? So logical incoherence is a different kind of problem, which science shares with other modes of scholarship. You don't want any scholarly discipline to be incoherent. And people have thought of both Marxism and Freudian psychology as incoherent, not just as unfalsifiable. So how do we bring these missing things? So I mentioned emotion. Let me mention a couple other entire regions of human experience that have been neglected by cognitive science. So, one of them is normativity. So whether it is in ethics, whether it is in art, so beauty, justice, the things that traditionally philosophers have talked about is more or less not present in the cognitive sciences. We again, as human beings, we spend a great deal of our lives sort of in the thrall of beauty or actually suffering because of injustice, and yet, on the whole, this sector of human experience is absent in the cognitive sciences. You could try to reduce questions of beauty or of justice to purely formal questions. So, for example, it's possible, and I know him very well, to look at moral grammar. So you can say that actually what makes us moral beings is the fact that we have a universal moral grammar, just as we have a universal grammar for language. Right? So John Michale, who's perhaps a preeminent theorist of this particular perspective, thinks of us having a moral grammar in the same way that we have a syntax for language. Now, nevertheless, that actually doesn't tell us, even if we had a moral grammar, and which actually tells you what's the problem with the Chomsky view about universal grammar as well, is that even if we had that, even if we had a moral grammar, even if we had a universal grammar for language, it actually doesn't tell us much about how we engage with language or with justice in the world of every, you know, human experience and interactions. And that's what that really matters to us. Meaning, if it turns out that all of us have exactly the same universal grammar, and all of us have exactly the same moral grammar, so we are, in some sense, formally equal, that formal equality actually doesn't really make a huge difference to us. I mean, if I'm unequal to you, if you are rich and I'm poor, it's not much consolation that in some abstract sense you and I both have the same moral grammar. Right? And so any discipline which sort of abstracts out and formalizes what is human nature often misses what is exactly the most relevant to us in our experience of our humanity. And that, I mean, no amount of computation is going to be able to address this gap. And which is where disciplines like embodied cognition, when they come in, they try very, very hard to not be formal for this reason. I mean, so when you think about it, there's a strategic sort of, you could say, academic warfare going on between the embodied camp and the computational camp. And the embodied camp will say that no, we are not, you know, formal logical devices. We are actually living fleshy beings. But I mean, apart from that rhetorical battle, there's a genuine reason, which is to say that without an awareness of the way in which we actually are embedded in the world, right? So the way in which we talk with our friends, are hurt by their statements, are moved by the beauty of poems and of literature, that is actually the stuff that we all want to understand. And if we don't have an account of that, and if we don't have a theory of human nature which informs those things, it's not a theory that will compel us and interest us.
In physical sciences, there I think is a parallel. Right? I probably am wrong, but it looks to me that, you know, while things like second law of thermodynamics kind of reduced it to a certain formalism, what's really interesting is the non-equilibrium thermodynamics. Mm-hmm. It's not the common and the static commonality between all of us that's interesting. Mm-hmm. It is the performance of that.
Sure. So. In the Chomskyan claim, competence might be there, but it's performance that is really
makes
we all can, right? That's what makes the world go around, so to speak. Of course, in physics, I don't know what it would have been in, say, 17th or 18th centuries, but now we are used to physics being a very abstract and remote science. I mean, nobody really expects to be a genuine sort of knower of quantum field theories unless you spend many, many years getting yourself educated. But that can't be. So that's why cognitive science is more like economics and less like physics in some ways. Because if, and economics, of course, is a huge problem because it claims to be this mathematical science which only sort of highly trained experts can understand, and yet it claims to organize our lives as well. And so it has this huge problem of trying to justify how you should live your life on the basis of some very abstract account that is completely inaccessible to you. And which, not surprisingly, leads to all kinds of disasters. But we can't have that. Cognitive science doesn't even have economics as expertise, right? So we can do one of two things. We can either try to play the same game as economics, and computational accounts of cognition sort of are beginning to do that. Right? So you have a very, very technical, mathematical, let's say, account of how minds work. And we say that because that's the way minds work, that's how education should happen, that's how we should, say voting, for example. So voting, education, decision making of various kinds, consumer behavior, all of these should be based on some heavy, very, very specialized, abstract account of human nature. Now, if that happens, well, fine, that will be a new priesthood that we can create, which will be useful for some people. But that, again, won't be a mass, that won't be really the idea of human nature that we can all engage with. So what's that? Is a potential cognitive science, which is much more, and that's why I keep coming back to phenomenology and experience and cognition, which is much more embedded in everyday life, but also recognizes that that everyday life isn't something which is without its expertise. So to give you an example, like great artists or writers or generally the creative class, right? I mean, we all understand that we can't write beautifully in the way that Tolstoy or Tagore or somebody like that wrote. So that expertise, if anything, is rarer than the expertise of a person who can do a good cognitive science experiment. And you could argue that their insight into human nature is also greater than that of the everyday cognitive scientist. And what was beautiful about Freud is that he combined this literary and the scientific. In fact, the only prize he ever got, a major prize, was not a science prize, it was the Goethe Prize for Literature. Right? So his writing, the reason why he's so popular is by the quality of his writing, not necessarily as much as by the power of the ideas. So if we see that is also a kind of expertise, right? It's an expertise which is hidden, as opposed to the physicist's expertise, which is obvious, right? So the mathematician and physicist's expertise is obvious because you can't understand her or his ideas. They put marks on a piece of paper and you have no idea what they're saying. But a great artist's expertise is to disguise what is extremely difficult in the form of something that is extremely accessible. Right? And that's a very different notion of expertise. And that kind of cognitive science is perhaps one model that we can adopt. And cognitive linguistics actually, to a large extent, has taken aspects of this way of understanding the mind, right? So if you read, say, Lakoff doesn't write in an ununderstandable manner. In fact, it seems just like describing various things. It almost feels like anybody could do it. Anybody could just make those lists of metaphors and count them again and again. And so what's the big deal in doing that? So unlike, say, Chomsky linguistics, where extremely formal calculations are being made, this seems sort of transparently obvious. But one shouldn't dismiss it for that reason. But that is the charm of it, right? So why we are all talking about, you know, metaphors of thought, or we all think metaphorically, is because somebody made that idea compelling enough that lots and lots of people can understand. So that combination of expertise and insight into everyday lives, I think will be an important shift in the way we understand the mind. Now, of course, that too will require sharp technological shifts, partly because as soon as you say, that's what I want to do, there is an issue of biology here. Because as of now, the only kind of, in fact, the only organism which you can study in this sort of literary fashion is humanity. I mean, we can't really study other species. But the fact of the matter is that we can no longer ignore the minds of other species if we want to understand the human mind. I mean, so how do you go outside the human sphere and yet maintain this phenomenological and experiential insight rather than just a technical one, will require us to develop technologies that will expand our reach into the non-human world, right? And that's going to be a very, very hard problem, because you barely have technologies that reach into other human beings, let alone other species. So that's going to be a big, big challenge. But it'll be interesting, because the more we find out about how minds work, it's clear that both human minds and the minds of other species are definitely related to each other. It's not like that, it's exactly the same. So there is the possibility that of Thomas Nagel's claim that we can never know what it's like to be a bat, right? But even if you think that that's not a in principle objection, so that it is possible to know what it's like to be a bat, it will still take a lot of effort to get to the mind of a bat, right? And I think that that will actually be the big, big challenge of the mind sciences for the next maybe few hundred years, which is how do you expand the scope of the experiential world, which is ultimately what cognitive science studies. We don't study neurons. We don't study brain systems. We ultimately study what beings think and feel and experience generally. So to the extent that we can expand the sphere of the study of experience to non-human species, we will be generalizing this field to all kinds of new things. And that's with what eventually make cognition a central discipline. Right? So the two things, therefore, that will make it, one is the integration of our understanding of the mind into these consumer technologies, things like phones and, I mean, Apple, in some sense, understands better how minds and bodies work than cognitive scientists do, right? Because they make these technologies that are transparent to you. You don't even feel like you're using a machine. You're just doing what you naturally do and stuff happens, right? I mean, that's the idea of a great technology. And of course, the design of Apple's technologies was greatly influenced at a certain time by Donald Norman, who wrote this, if you haven't read it, you should. It's a book called The Design of Everyday Things. Right? And Donald Norman is a cognitive psychologist in the J.J. Gibson mode. So affordances and things which most cognitive scientists don't hear about are standard learning skills for designers. So once you think of, therefore, so one direction, what I would say that the cognitive sciences need to go to understand and become far more influential than they are is this integration into the, let's broadly call them the creative disciplines, right? So design, visual arts, narrative arts, and so on and so forth. Because that's where you can imagine the insights. We'll both learn more from how people are both delighted and terrorized by artistic endeavors, and we will also inform those artistic endeavors. So that's sort of the technology side, right? So the technology applications of the mind sciences will be in computer science, design, these kinds of things. On the other hand, the science side of it, I think, will greatly benefit from expanding beyond the human. Because one huge problem that cognitive science traditionally has had is that it sticks to the human world. I mean, in fact, language has been the single biggest phenomenon that cognitive scientists have studied. Vision, slightly secondarily so. But actually, when you think about it, language is probably something that only one species has. And vision, and the centrality of vision, is a relatively, I mean, it's primates in general are visual species, but on the whole, the animal world is not driven by vision, right? I mean, bacteria, for example, don't use vision that much. So chemical signaling is far, far more common than visual, sensorium, and the visual part of the world. So once we are able to get out of this prison of language and vision, we may be able to do a lot more in the cognitive sciences and expand that to other species. So emotion and the body, which are sort of things that every species, at least certainly emotion is present in its limbic manifestation all the way to reptiles, if not before. Right? So it has a much, much larger reach. And embodiment is something that every species has, right? So from a bacterium to a human being, we have a body, but not a sort of a dead body, not just a physics body, but a body that actually does something for us, right? So every species inhabits its body. And so potentially, embodied cognition is not a science of just human cognition, but actually a building block of our understanding of biology as a whole. So once, I mean, that's of course, I think, I don't know, decades if not centuries in the future, but I do think that that's going to be the long-term successful strategy of the mind sciences, if we can go there. So what I've covered so far is sort of a mishmash of these three, right? How did we get here? What is left out? Where do we go next? I mean, what I wanted to impress on you, of course, is this is an open area with many, many small questions, many, many medium questions, and many, many large questions, right? So there is a very large question like, what's it like to be a bat? And how do I really get into the mind of some other species? There are many small questions. So for example, pretty much, so India, for example, is a huge, huge source of small questions. Meaning, the way in which, if you take standard cognitive science, which is focused on vision and language, there are just so many things to be studied in India which are not that easy to study in the West. So language, we are a fantastic country to be students of language because we have so many languages that intermingle with each other that even basic ideas about the nature of language can be tested. So even if you are a Chomskyan, where you believe that there is universal grammar, our ideas of universal grammar have come from sort of single language studies, meaning the claim being that you have exactly one mother tongue and the language acquisition device sort of takes auditory input and produces that mother tongue as its output. So it's a sort of single language driven idea of how grammar works. But in a country where many of us learn multiple languages in the home, right? We are not learning, unlike in Europe or in other parts of the world where you might learn English in school, but until then you have spoken French or German or whatnot. In India, we are mostly learning every language that we know on the street. And that's a huge difference, because you could argue it's a more natural setting in which language is learned. It's also learned differently. So which means that you are not likely to learn fancy vocabulary, but you are more likely to be facile and conversational in other languages. So that might, that's what I would call, say, normative multilingualism. So what if the language acquisition device, as an overall hypothesis, was not designed to be a single language acquisition thing, but something that intrinsically had multiple languages built into it? So a pop evolutionary history might be that in the distant past, when human language was evolving, each human group probably had its own language. In fact, even now in Papua New Guinea, you can go a couple of miles and you suddenly will have a radically different language. Right? So language contact between these groups, again, another sort of evolutionary assumption is that different human groups were meeting each other and trading or otherwise in social relations all the time. So if that's the case, it's possible that actually human language arose in a multilingual sort of language contact setting rather than a unilingual first language learning setting. And if that's the case, well, studying something like that in India would be the obvious thing to do, because there's so many languages that are here. So even therefore for the standard model, there's plenty of stuff to be done in India if you know how to ask the right questions. So one of the things that these summer schools are supposed to do is to say that what are the opportunities for cognitive sciences sitting here in India, not some random, abstract idea of how to study the mind if you were sitting at Harvard or at MIT, but what are the things that we can do here that would be harder to do somewhere else? And these projects that are there in the summer school, therefore, are also to get you thinking in a research direction. Okay, I mean, it's very easy to come to a summer school, learn some lectures, and go back. But I mean, that's not fun for me, and it's sort of a waste of time for you as well. Right? So it's much better if you took these opportunities and say, okay, I'm going to start developing. Maybe spend some time thinking about questions that are around me, study human behavior, study language, study vision, study all kinds of stuff that's wherever you are, and I'm sure you'll find interesting questions to ask. So I hope that you use that opportunity. Questions?